Hawking had set out to write a book that would carry his message to a wider audience and make him a bit of cash to help pay for the expensive specialist care he needed. But he never anticipated the upset it would cause in his personal life. After years of caring for Hawking alone, his wife Jane suddenly found herself surrounded by nurses and assistants. In an interview in 2000, Hawking's youngest son Timothy recalled how, when he was 9 years old, his life was turned upside down.
Yeah, it just changed things completely. You know, had a lot of new people coming in to the house, wandering in and out. You know, the front door was always open. I think my mum found it hard because nurses started treating our house as their own home. You know, taking baths, helping themselves to food. And, you know, our sort of house was turning into a hospital. It started to unsettle the balance of the family. Suddenly, my dad seemed to become a lot more outgoing with people outside the house. He was starting to let his hair down in some ways. He started buying Beatles CDs and stuff and, you know, having parties. And the fact he could also, of course, be more independent now that he had his nurses. And that actually made his life easier, which meant that he didn't really have to be with my mum 24 hours a day.
2 years after his book's publication, Hawking and his wife Jane were separated. In 1995, he married his nurse, Elaine Mason.
I'm marrying the woman I love.
And the world waited eagerly for his much-vaunted theory of everything.
When The Brief History of Time first came out, I think physicists were fairly hopeful that we would have this final theory of everything, maybe within just a few decades.
In 1988, there was certainly cause for optimism. Only gravity had to be explained and brought into the fold. Back in the 1970s, Hawking had already given physics an inkling of how it might work.
By applying quantum mechanics to the edge of the black holes in the 1970s, I was able to revolutionize our understanding of them.
Hawking had proved it was possible to unite the theories of the very large, stars, planets, and gravity, as originally proposed in Einstein's theory of relativity, and blend in some of the theory of the very tiny, of atoms, quantum mechanics.
To expand our understanding further, we need to bring quantum mechanics into the heart of the black hole.
By joining the theories of the large and the tiny, in a limited way, Hawking had utterly changed our picture of black holes. He showed they chew up our universe, but then explode, giving off vast amounts of energy and material that eventually forms new stars. Physicists were fascinated. It was as if Hawking had pulled down a wall. Suddenly, the theorists of the very large and the theorists of the very small had something to talk to each other about. If Hawking could find a connection between the large and the tiny in black holes, there must be more. Surely, a single theory of the universe could be found that would include how gravity worked, both now and at the universe's beginning. The race was on. Hawking first became enthused about an idea called supersymmetry. Supersymmetry is based on the notion that before the Big Bang, when the universe was just a single point, everything, including gravity, was merged with perfect symmetry into one almighty superforce.
We think that at the instant of creation, there was a super force, a master force, a single force that governed the properties of this dot-like universe. But then the universe began to expand, and the force cracked.
When the universe began, the superforce was entirely symmetrical. It was made of the same stuff, and it all behaved in the same way. But then as it expanded, this symmetry started to break. In the milliseconds after the Big Bang, forces flew off in all directions, and the universe became messy and uneven. Gravity and all the other parts of nature we see today are the irregular, imperfect descendants of the original symmetry. The theory of supersymmetry solved part of the problem Hawking had with gravity. Now the whole of nature, including gravity, could be unified at the Big Bang by one set of equations. But there was still a problem. If gravity was unified with everything else at the Big Bang, why did it become so very weak afterwards, compared to the other forces? The brightest minds, like Hawking and Princeton professor Ed Witten, were trying to work out how the perfection of supersymmetry broke and ended up as the world we see today.
Imagine sitting down at a dinner table. There's a glass to your left and there's a glass to your right. So the arrangement of the table has a symmetry between left and right, at least for the glasses. It works fine if everybody picks up the glass on the left or if everyone picks up the glass on the right. But a mixture where everybody sits down and ends up with the glass breaks the symmetry. You all pick the glass from the left or the glass from the right. That's an example of what physicists call spontaneous symmetry breaking. And it's ubiquitous in the real world, both for the electrons in a piece of iron and for the early universe settling down from the Big Bang.
Explaining why the universe had settled down the way it had was the next problem Hawking had to solve. Supersymmetry made lots of sense, but there seemed to be no particular reason why gravity should end up so weak. Much work still needed to be done, but Hawking's ability to communicate was slowing down drastically. Today, it is a constant effort.
I'm going to demonstrate using a hand switch, which is what Professor Hawking used to use until about 2 years ago. Now, he uses a menu system, which is basically a big screen full of words. And when he presses the switch once, you see this highlighted section that goes up and down. That's actually selecting which part of the screen he wants to speak from. So if you press it and then press it again while it's over the top half, it's now worked out that he wants to say something in the top half of the screen. And if you press it a third time on the right line, it'll go along that line, and a fourth time lets you select a letter. And now we've got a whole screen full of words beginning with Q and R, and you can do the same thing again, and you can select a word. That's how he builds up a sentence, word by word, or if he wants to speak a word that isn't in the list, he can do it letter by letter as well.
EIJ is rescaled exponential.
Throughout the 90s, at only 4 words a minute, Hawking worked away at the problem of gravity. But cutting-edge physics became increasingly dependent on complex maths, and Hawking was reliant on students and colleagues to perform computations.
That's about long short of it.
Thank you very much.
The next big breakthrough came not from Hawking, but from a colleague just down